can you loose? You're gonna be loose like a goose. You're gonna be loose, 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 loose. You're gonna be so free. You're gonna be so free.
Troubled hearts with
this is about giving your life and laying you all on the altar and say, God, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll say what you want me to say, and I'll be what you want me to be. Not my will, but thy will be done. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound into Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise, go into the city, it shall be told thee what thou must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him unto Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, neither did eat nor drink. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, and he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight. Inquire for the house of Judas, for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayeth, and has seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. And Ananias answered, said, Lord, I have heard by many of this man, how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And yea, he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles, the kings, and the children of Israel. For I'll show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said unto him, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way, as thou camest, has sent me, that thou mayest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately it fell from his eyes, as it had been scales. And he received sight forthwith, and arose and was baptized, and received meat. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. And then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. Now I want you to notice down here in verse 3, it says, as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And then if you know, in verse 17, Ananias, when he laid hands upon him, he said, Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest. So something happened here, it's evident, in the life of Saul, that in the first three, we read about it, talking about a light shining from heaven. But in verse 17, Ananias refers to that light as being the Lord Jesus who appeared unto him in the way. Now, we all know the outcome of what transpired in the life of Saul of Tarsus. Here he is, one of the greatest persecutors of the Christian church, breathing out threatenings. And yet, he has what you could call a head-on collision with the Holy Ghost. He has an encounter with Jesus. And his life is radically transformed. His name, first of all, is changed from Saul to Paul. God, we always say this, God hit him so hard he knocked the S off his name and stuck a P there. I always was concerned when the Lord first touched me. I was concerned he was going to change my name from Rodney to Odney. Amen. But something happens when the Lord touches you. Something transpires. Something takes place in your life when he touches you. You see, I remember what happened to me growing up in a Pentecostal home, really. And I concur with my dear brother Ashley said, you know, you grow up in a Christian, in a godly home. You know, grow up in all-night prayer meetings. as a child, playing with your little automobiles under the coffee table as people are falling under the power, you know. And just really got born again when I was 5 and filled with the Spirit when I was 8 years of age. But never really had what you could say, an encounter with God, something that would be radical. It's always easy for somebody, I think, you know, I wouldn't know any different because I don't know any different, but it's always seemed easier for somebody who comes out of a heathen lifestyle. You're on their way to hell and with both guns blazing, you see. And then they get saved. But when you've only known the way of the cross, and I'm not saying that you don't have problems in your life and that you don't have to overcome the flesh and that you don't have to overcome sin. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about those that have practiced sin as a way of life, that have never known the way of the cross, that have never known the life of God on the inside of them. It's a little different. It just would seem to me, again, I don't know, because I just gave my life to the Lord when I was 5 years of age. You know, I can't say that I was saved out of a life of crime and drugs. I say the Lord saved me. One thing He did save me out of was tradition and religion. Can you say amen? Come on now. But I mean, all I could get arrested for at the age of 5 was robbing the cookie jar or belting my brother up the side of his head when he needed it. But no, I'm teasing. But I mean, nonetheless, that happened. But, you know, it's just, I knew in my life that I needed to have a touch from God. I knew if God had called me to the ministry, then I needed to have an encounter with God. I knew that I needed to have His fire. I knew that He needed to come and touch me. And you know, it would really irritate me when I'd read in the book of Acts what happened to Saul. I thought, my God, that can't happen to me. I mean, I'm not out killing the church. Maybe I'm going to have to go and grow up and backslide and then go out and do something real bad that then God can come and save me from. Then I'll have a testimony, because I don't really have a testimony, you know. I mean, what am I going to say? What do I say? Hello. And so I really started to get hungry for God. And hunger doesn't come overnight. Hunger is not something that you went to bed one night and you weren't hungry for God, and then suddenly you just woke up and you was hungry for God. Hunger is something that comes over a period of time. Hunger is a process. Spiritual hunger is a process. One thing I realized, God wants to visit everybody. If God would come and visit Saul of Tarsus, then God wants to come and visit me. Now, the way He comes and visits me might be a whole lot different than the way He comes and visits Saul of Tarsus, but nonetheless, He wants to come and visit me. He wants to come and visit you. I like the way you pray, Ashley. I like the way you pray. That kind of prayer gets God's attention. That kind of prayer makes religious people nervous, but it doesn't make God nervous. He smiles and He moves and He acts. He likes that. He wants you to talk that way to Him. He likes it. He's looking for people that will cry out to Him. He's looking for people that are hungry and they're thirsty and they would cry out and say, oh God, come and touch me. Come and fill me. Come and change me, you know. And it's an ongoing process, you see. Just because you were touched 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, doesn't mean to say that you can't be touched any longer, because it's an ongoing process where we're being changed from glory unto glory. Now, there would be people that would even be sitting here this night that you would say, well, Brother Rodney, I mean, can't just God come and just do it all? No, He couldn't, because you couldn't handle it all. God couldn't just come and just zap everybody and just do it all. You physically could not handle that. I mean, I've seen people just get touched a little bit and they scream the house down. So you can imagine if God just came and zapped them with a full load. You know what I'm saying? I mean, my God. They're carrying them out. They'd be gone for days. Amen. He gets you just enough and so that you can't maybe function for a while, but then you come back so that you can go about your daily duties and your bodily functions. You know what I'm saying? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Thank God for that. Amen. Hallelujah. But He wants to touch everybody. But you know what? He's no respecter of persons. And he's looking for hunger, and he's looking for thirst, and he's looking for the heart that will cry out, and the individual that will say, God, I don't really care what you do, but just come and do something. I don't really care what other people think. God, just come by your power, come by your fire, and come and touch me. Listen, because you see, it's fine. And I think this was the case with me, because I've been reading after men like Smith Wigglesworth and John G. Lake, especially those two, Wigglesworth and John G. Lake, you see, because both of them had an incredible impact upon the country of Southern Africa. Both of them were mightily used of God in our nation. And so, you know, John G. Lake and Wigglesworth, I mean, those were two names that stuck out in my mind and in my consciousness, you know, as I was just seeking after God. I'd get a hold of things about them, and people would tell me, some of the older men of God, you know, that had lived during those times would tell me about some of the great moves and things that happened. And I looked at the church in its current condition back then, and I said, now God, that's just not fair, that you would come and you would move a supernatural way through Wigglesworth, and you'd move a supernatural way through John G. Lake. But what about us? Are we chopped liver? I mean, do you not care about us? What about us, God? What about us? I mean, you know, whatever we've got to do, just tell us, we'll do it. I don't care. Lord, I'm so desperate for you that if you told me to go stand in the corner on my head and clap my feet and that great revival would break up, I'd count it an honor and a privilege to go and stand in the corner on my head and clap my feet. I don't really care what other people think about me. I don't care what other people say. Lord, I'm hungry. Lord, I'm thirsty. Lord, I'm desperate. I've got to have more of you. I've got to have a touch from you. Lord, I've got to. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty, oh God. I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty, you see. I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty. I'm hungry. You've got to come. You must come, and you must come and touch me. And not next week, not next month, but you've got to come now, you see. And through a series of events, which I won't go into now, things begin to change for me. The month of August of 1978, through a series of events that took place really leading up to July of 1979, where I really just began to get so desperate for God. As I always tell people, it's a process. It's when you wake up in the morning, when you lie down, when you're walking around, you might not even look like you're praying, but from your toes, you're crying out. Every pore in your body is crying out, oh, I must have more of God. This is where people go wrong. They go into a closet somewhere, or they go and they kneel down in certain positions and they cry out in a religious manner, but their heart, they're crying out from their mouth, and their body on the outside makes the sign that they're hungry, but really in their heart, they're not that hungry. They're not really that thirsty. They're doing a religious duty. They're going through a religious motion, you see. But this was not, I wasn't doing any certain religious kind of thing. I was just crying out from my innermost being. And you know what? Someone said, well, I don't understand how God touched Saul of Tarsus, because he sure wasn't hungry. Did you know that sometimes people that oppose God the most are the hungriest, searching for God? That's why they oppose God in the way that they do, because Saul was looking for the truth. He was looking for reality. And I'm telling you right now, his anger against the church of the day, his anger against the church at that time, as he was breathing out threatenings, really was not an anger against the church, but was an anger against Almighty God, that really, I believe in his heart of hearts, he was really kind of trying to dare God. He was really trying to put God to the test. And I'll tell you what, right now, he bit off a little bit more than he could chew. I'm telling you right now, because as he was on his way, as he was on the road, as he's riding down the road on his horse, and Jesus came and stood in front of him, and he fell to the ground. I'm telling you, he heard the voice from heaven, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? He asked the question, but he answered it in the same sentence, because it was so awesome that he knew it could only be one. This is the one I'm looking for. Who art thou, Lord? I am Jesus, whom you persecute. I'll tell you what, he had a head-on collision that day that totally transformed his life. And in reading the scripture, in reading the book of Acts, reading after the upper room and what took place and what transpired when 120 people were gathered together in one accord in one place. And suddenly, there's that word suddenly again, you see. We find it in verse 3, and then we find it in Acts chapter 2. Suddenly a light shone from heaven. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a mighty rushing wind, filled all the house where they're sitting, appeared on them cloven tongues, like as a fire set upon each of them, all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I said, Lord, now listen, I've seen people get the Holy Ghost in today. I've seen them. I watch it. They just kind of shun ba 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 shun diddy bo diddy ba ba ba. It's just kind of like a just, it's just, I mean, you know, I heard the story of this cowboy preacher. He was out and he was preaching out in an Indian reservation out west. This is years ago, right about the turn of the century. And he was preaching out there. And as he's preaching, and there was this big Indian chief sitting on the front row. And the Indian chief come to him right at the end of the series of meetings that he's holding. He said, me no want. The Indians talk, Indian chief said, me no want. Little Holy Ghost go, hallelujah, hallelujah. Me want big Holy Ghost go, hallelujah, hallelujah. And so this Indian chief had been sitting there and he'd been watching people getting the Holy Ghost. And he decided to himself that he didn't want little Holy Ghost. He wanted big Holy Ghost. I remember that story was told to me when I was a little kid. And I'll never forget. I mean, I was only 7, 8 years old when I heard that story told to me. And I thought, yeah, I want to be like that Indian chief. I want big Holy Ghost. I don't want little Holy Ghost. I want little Holy Ghost. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I want big Holy Ghost. Go, hallelujah! I want big Holy Ghost, big Holy Ghost. And that's what I could see. Wigglesworth must have had big Holy Ghost. And John G. Lake must have had big Holy Ghost. And I wanted to have big Holy Ghost. Oh, if others can have it, why can't I have big Holy Ghost? I must have big Holy Ghost. I've got to have big Holy Ghost. I've got to have big Holy Ghost. Because I know if I can have big Holy Ghost, then my life is going to change, you see. Then I won't go around, he loves you, he loves you. Get saved, get saved. There'll be no power with that kind of little weak touch, just kind of little cruise-o-matic. I didn't want a cruise-o-matic, just kind of like, bom, 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 bom. Sound like a motorboat going down the river. Shom, bom, 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 bom. I wanted big Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Combo diddy baha. Oh, shapakadi mende better bendi glambondo. Brundidi ba shukoda dea. Hoo ba ba siya pada baba nana manfiyata. And really, I said, Lord, now if you could give it to them, you can give it to me. I'm telling you, you know, these are the things that go on in your spirit. These are the things that you might be driving down the road. You might be coming to and from the camp meeting service. You might be greeting people. You might be talking to them. But in your heart of hearts, you're crying out, me want big Holy Ghost. Me want big Holy Ghost. Me don't want little Holy Ghost. Go, hallelujah, hallelujah. Me want big Holy Ghost, you see. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Just like that preacher of old that prayed a prayer back in the early 1900s, he said, Lord, African-American preacher said, Lord, dip me in the kerosene of thy spirit and set my heart ablaze that I may burn for you. Oh, hallelujah. Take me and dip me in the kerosene of thy spirit and set my heart ablaze that I may burn for you. And I remember praying and said, now, God, I want your fire. I've been speaking in tongues since I was 8 years of age. But he said, I'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. Now, I know the Holy Ghost. I knew the Holy Ghost, but I wanted fire. Some people are afraid of the fire. One preacher got up and said, all this fire meetings where the fire is falling. He said, just now going to burn the whole church up. I thought, yeah, if it's carnal, it will build the home, burn the whole church up. In the United Kingdom, recently they've been having after the fire conferences. What to do when there's no more fire? Oh, my God. There's always fire. What do you mean after the fire? After the rain. We're having an after the rain conference. Who wants to attend? My God, I want to go to no after the rain conferences, after the fire conferences. Just like the prophet of old that said an angel took a coal off the altar and came and placed it on his lips. He said, woe is me, I'm undone, I'm a man of unclean lips. And an angel came and took a coal off the altar and came and placed the coal on his lips. And immediately man had a conversation with God. That's what the prophet of God said. That's why the prophet of God said, it's just like a fire shut up in my bones. I want you to know something tonight. You can see people that have had a touch of the fire. You can look in the eyes and you can see it burning. They might not even say a thing. You'll just watch them closely and you'll see the fire is burning. They're just walking along, just walking along. And you look and say, oh, I see fire on him. Where God takes heaven's firebrand and takes it right out of the flames and just takes it and burns it on your heart. Pssh. And you don't have to say a word, but the mark is there. You carry in yourself the mark of heaven. You can't get rid of it. You've been touched. You've been touched. You've been touched. Now you say, why did God touch Saul of Tarsus? Because I don't think there's anybody in this place that's worse than Saul of Tarsus. And God is trying to tell people, if I could take Saul of Tarsus, the lowly of the low, I could take anybody in this house and I could touch them and I can use them tonight. I could set them free. I could put my fire on the inside of them. Saul of Tarsus, who went on to go and write 2/3 of the New Testament. Oh, what a transformation. Now known as the Apostle Paul, as Saint Paul. He was anything but a saint. He was an ain't. I think that's God took the S off Saul and stuck it on the ain't and put it there and made him a saint. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 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 And so I can't get hungry for you. You must get hungry for yourself. Everyone's at a different place in your walk with God. Everyone, the Spirit of God is speaking to you now about things that need to change, attitudes that need to be adjusted, things that you need to get out the way. That I'm telling you right now, that in order for God to touch you in a way that He wants to touch you, these things need to go. I'm telling you, God will begin to speak to you. Those things. Someone said, well, won't the fire burn it up? Yeah, the fire will. But those things are stopping you from even being hungry. The things that I'm talking about getting out the way are the things that stop you from being hungry to where you get desperate, to where you even press in. Because there's a lot of people just sit, but they're not pressing in. They're not pushing in. They're not pushing in. They're not saying, this is mine. This is my night tonight. 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 I'm pressing in. It's that kind of tenacity. It's that kind of, oh yes, my God, that hunger that comes deep from the inside of you where you say, I've got to have it now. And God will honor that. God will honor that. And I came to that place. I remember July 1979. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I tell you, it might even be just exactly 20 years ago tonight. I don't know. Or 19 years. What is it? 20? Is it 20? 19 years ago. 19 years ago. Who knows that maybe Madison Square Garden, when we stand there preaching, one of those nights, it was 20 years ago that he touched with the fire. I'm telling you right now, without the fire of God, I wouldn't even be standing here today. Because the fire of God is a thing that'll burn you through the circumstances of life and just keep you going. Just keep you going. The fire will come and burn off everything that is periphery. The fire of God will burn off everything that's not important. And the Holy Ghost, even though you might go here and go there, the Spirit of God will just protect you and just keep you. And He'll hover and He'll brood over you. And He'll protect you and keep you in the palm of His hand. Because He knows there's a work and there's a plan and there's a purpose. And that which He wants to do on the inside of you. Can you say amen? I just thought about that. July 79, July 99, 20 years. I don't know, maybe, who knows? But I got to a place of desperation where I cried out and said, Lord, I'm so hungry for You, I'm so desperate for You. We were in actual fact, just about when were we in Edmonton, Alberta? When were we there? When? Who can tell me? When? Who? Help. End of May. When? We were in Edmonton. And in that meeting in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, a lady asked if she could see me before the service when I came in the Friday night. And when I walked out, I looked at her. She was the girl that was there with me right on in the meetings that we conducted right after the Spirit of God touched me. I mean, she said, I remember those very first meetings. I remember those very first services with the anointing of God. She said, I've never forgotten that. She said, when I've been up here in Canada, people said, is this revival real? She said, I remember when it first fell. She said, it's real, it's very real. She said, I'm telling you right now, I know I was there. I just remember that. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so I was desperate. I was hungry. I was thirsty. I told the Lord, said, Lord, either You come down and touch me or I'm going to die and come up there and touch You. Now, those are desperate words to tell God. But you know what? He don't mind. Like, God's not fazed. He didn't even break out in a sweat. He didn't bother Him. If you're talking like that, He's just looking for somebody to talk to. He's just looking for somebody who'll be bold enough to come to God on that basis. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth. He's looking for people that He can show Himself strong in their behalf. And so when you come on that basis of prayer, when you come boldly up the throne of God, say, God, either You come down and touch me or I'll die and come up there and touch You. Then God says, okay, I'll move. I'll come visit you. Don't matter where you are. I'll come visit you. He'll come visit you in Africa. He'll come visit you in Asia. He'll come visit you in Australia. He'll come visit you in Europe. He'll come visit you in America. Can you say amen? And I'm telling you right now, you see, everybody, I'm even going to say this to you, because some of you have come here to this camp meeting this week hoping to be touched by God, and all that's just fine, and that's just great, and God might touch you, that's just wonderful. We'll be so happy. But I'll tell you what, I'd much rather prefer if you went home and in your bed, by your bed, you kneeled by your bed, amen, and then the fire of God come touch you there. Then when you walk out, you can say, the Lord touched me, the hand of the Lord touched me. You don't have to say, I went to a Rodney Howard-Browne meeting and got touched. Because, see, I've been taking the blame for people getting touched for a long time. And I'd much rather you just blame it. You know what I'm saying? It's much easier for people to just say, well, God just touched me, than say, some man touched me. Can you say amen? Because it's not about a man touching you, even though God does use people. Yes, He does. We know that. But I'll tell you, you know, today, and in these days we're living in, it's come down to the man who touched the man who touched the man who touched the man who touched me. And I mean, really, my God have mercy. Who gives a cotton picking rip? Who was the man that touched the man that touched the man who touched the man that touched me? Well, I got touched by, I was touched by John G. Lake. Well, I was touched by the Apostle Paul. What's wrong with you? Well, I got touched by Maria Woodsworth Edda. Well, I was touched by Catherine Coleman. Well, I got touched by the bones of Elijah. I mean, give me a break. Ultimately, you were touched by the hand of God. And I wanted God to touch me. And that's one of the things that we prayed about in these meetings since this revival broke out, and even prior to the revival broke out, because we knew God wanted to touch people after he touched me. But one of the things we prayed about said, Lord, please touch your people. Touch them in a way that they know that you touch them, and we didn't do it. That's why there are many times when we don't even lay hands on people. We just say, lift your hands as you do, the power of God comes on you. And the power of God knocks them on the floor so they can know that God touched them. Because something happens when you know that God touched you. Something happens when you know that he touched you. The Apostle Paul could boldly say, I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. Where did he get it from? From the Lord. From the Lord. God wants to touch you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And yes, he'll use people. He'll use men. Or I tell you, he or I'm yeah. Come. He'll use men as igniters. That's all I am, as a fire lighter. I come and light a fire and watch it burn. And then have to come back a year later to see if it's still burning. And maybe stick a poker in and shake the grate and throw a couple of more logs on. Hallelujah. But I'll tell you what, if he can touch me, he can touch you. If he can touch me, he can touch you. All you got to do is be hungry. All you got to do is be thirsty. All you got to do, all you have to do is just cry out. No. Don't come with preconceived ideas. Don't come with the way, well, he's going to touch me this way and he's going to do that. Don't come to him with preconceived ideas about the way you think God's going to touch you. Don't. You make a mistake. You miss it. Don't come to him with the way he's going to touch you. You'll miss it. No. You come to him just hungry and he'll touch you. Don't come with the way he's going to touch you. Don't work it out. You'll miss it. Don't do it. Don't do it, because the way you think he's going to touch you, that's not the way he's going to touch you. He'll touch you some other way. I didn't know what was going to happen that night as I began to cry out to God, and I started shouting where we were. I'll tell you, about 18 people were there where we were. And I began to cry out to God, just shout at the top of my lungs, God, I want your fire. God, I want your fire. But this wasn't just somebody just walking in and say, I think I'll have the fire. God, I want your fire. This was a year of just things going over in my spirit. Just every waking moment, when you get out of bed, when you lie down, things that you're dealing with, battling with in your own life, and just fears and all kinds of things that God's trying to bring you out of and bring you into a place of victory, and you're just crying out to him. I knew I had to have a head-on collision with God, and I knew that if he could touch the Saul of Tarsus, he could come and touch me. Because I knew if I was going to go into the ministry, I had to go with a little bit more than just a couple of Rondies and a few Shondies and a couple of Tama bow ties and who shot the pecan downs. I knew if I was going to go and obey the call of God, I had to go with a little more than, because I'd seen that all my life. them old time Pentecostal ladies with the big hat on their hair and got so much fruit on top of their hat. You know what I'm saying? With one of them big hat pins and they're... And then the hat to fall off and they'd shake the bun out of their hair and whatever. I'd seen that. I'd watched all that. I knew I didn't want to go into the ministry with a shandala babanda. I wanted to go with something more than a shandala babanda. And I shouted for about 20 minutes. I never felt a thing, never felt anything. If you'd asked me, how are you doing? I said, still trying. I mean, I'm still drilling. I haven't got there. I mean, I never felt a thing, never felt a thing. My voice started to get hoarse. But I didn't stop. I just cried, God, I want your fire. Now someone said, you don't have to shout. God's not deaf. No, he's not deaf, but he's not nervous either. I was not shouting. I was not shouting for him, I was shouting for me. Because if I didn't shout, I'd say, God, I want your fire. And then I would have ended up with just a little Holy Ghost. And I didn't just want little Holy Ghost, you see. Hallelujah. God, I want your fire! Now, I'm telling you, the most amazing thing happened. That's why those words suddenly mean so much to me, because they jump out of the page and hit me in the middle of the forehead. And I understand what suddenly means, because it was that suddenly. It was like somebody took gasoline and just poured it over my whole body and just set me alight. I mean, my whole body just began to burn like fire, just like tingling, like pins and needles, but it wasn't. It was good. It was a good feeling. The only way I can describe to you what it felt like is when you go home tonight, go to your bedside table lamp, unscrew the light bulb, put your finger in the socket, and you'll understand exactly what it felt like. It was awesome. It was wonderful. It was glorious. And the fire of God was burning from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. And just instantaneously, I was immediately what you might call drunk on the new wine of the Holy Ghost. Instantaneously, I was beside myself. Instantaneously, I was just laughing uncontrollably, just filled with joy, unspeakable and full of glory. And then just go from laughter to just weeping, just crying. I mean, just boo-hooing. But it wasn't a cry of sadness, it was a cry of joy. And then I go from laughter to weeping, to speaking other tongues, to weeping, to laughter, to speaking other tongues, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards. And 1 hour went by, 2 hours went by, 3 hours went by, 4 hours went by, 5 hours went by, 6 hours went by, 1 day went by, 2 days went by, 3 days went by. In the fourth day, now I'm not praying, oh God, send your fire. Now I was a nervous wreck. I thought, my God, he heard my prayer. He heard me say, either you come down and touch me, or I'll die and come up there and touch you. And now he's come down and touched me. Now he's going to kill me and take me home. Now I start to pray, Lord, I'm too young to die. Please don't kill me now. I didn't want to die then. I wanted to have a wife by the name of Adonica and have 3 kids by the name of Kirsten, Kelly, and Kenneth. I didn't want to die. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Aren't you happy? I'm teasing. Now, you should be. And so, in the fourth day, you know, I wasn't praying, God, send your fire anymore. I'm saying, Lord, just lift it so that I can bear it. I know why we're going to have a glorified body, because otherwise we'd get to heaven and we wouldn't be able to even stand the presence of God. We'd just be crawling around on all fours, because this physical body could not take too much of the presence of God. That's why this physical body needs to become a spiritual body that can stand in the glory and in the presence of God. This corruptible must be put on incorruptible. This mortality must put on immortality, so that we can stand and walk and live and dwell in the presence of Almighty God. Otherwise, when we get to heaven, we'll just be on our faces all the time. That's what happened, you know. John was on the Isle of Patmos, and Jesus, you said, the Bible says in the book of Revelation chapter 1, John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. The Amplified Version says, I was wrapped in His presence. And then Jesus came to him and said, I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. And he said, I fell at His feet as dead. You see, that's what happened. And that's what happened to Saul. He fell at the feet of Jesus, hallelujah, and was converted. Well, my whole body was affected by the presence of God. Some people say, I got touched, but I didn't really feel anything. I'm telling you right now, that's like saying I stuck my hand in a light socket, but I never felt anything. My God, that means that there was no electricity flowing into the light socket if you never felt anything. That's like saying, I got my finger jammed in the automobile door, but I never felt a thing. That means you must be paralyzed if you never felt a thing. That means you have no feeling. You have no feeling whatsoever. Now, there are people that say that we preach an experience. You better believe I preach an experience, because I'm talking about meeting the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And when you meet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, it is an experience. Everything about life is an experience. Being born is an experience. Giving birth is an experience. Riding a roller coaster is an experience. Coming to one of these meetings is an experience. Drinking a cup of coffee is an experience. Eating fried chicken is an experience. Yum, yum, it's an experience. And now we come to God and we meet the Creator of heaven and earth, and we meet Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's an experience you'll never forget. That's why when He touches you, you gotta tell everybody about it. You gotta shout it from the rooftops. You gotta shout it from the mountaintops. I met Him, I met Him, I met Him. I wanna tell you about Jesus. I wanna tell you about Jesus. I wanna tell you about Him. I'm gonna tell you about Him. I'm gonna tell you about Him. He healed my body. He set me free. He delivered me from drugs and alcohol and all the things of the world. Oh, I gotta tell you. I gotta tell you about Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, I gotta tell you. And somebody said, you're emotional, be quiet. Don't get carried away. I can't help it. He touched me. What do you mean, be quiet? I can't. I gotta tell you. He touched me. He changed my life. What do you mean? What do you mean, be quiet? I can't be quiet. I'm gonna shout it. I'm gonna tell somebody. I've just seen Jesus.
I've just seen Jesus. He's alive.
He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know. He touched me and made me whole. It's not about looking at somebody else that's flipping over the backside of a chair and saying, oh, well, what's wrong with them? It's about you plugging in to what God wants to do for you. That's what this is all about. It's not about anybody putting on anything, because you know what? If he didn't touch you, you wouldn't want to act like he did touch you, because then you would be lying anyway. This is real. This is genuine. You don't have to make it happen. When he touches you, you'll know all about it, dear friends. You'll know all about it. I said, you'll know all about it. Somebody come to me and said, Brother Rodney, I think God touched me. I said, he didn't. Because when he touched you, you don't think anymore. You know, haha. Oh, yeah. You know he touched you. He know. He know. He know you know. He know you know he touched you. Hallelujah. 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 Now I must say this, that anointing, that fire, the Lord just, he lifted it so that I could bear it, but it stayed lightly for about 2 weeks. I was just conscious of his presence and just thankful for his touch and just thankful for his glory that was on my life. I just was conscious of it. Hallelujah. And God begun to do a work. Begun. I never said he finished. He's still doing it. He's still doing it. 19 years later, he's still doing it. He's still doing it. But I want him to do more. I don't know about you. Come here, brother. Come here. This brother over here. Come here. Quickly. Come here. Bring him here. Bring him here. Come here. Quickly. Bring him here. Come hither. Bring him out here. Bring him here. Come here. Lift your hands. Never the same. This man's a Baptist preacher. Baptist preacher. Isn't that right, sir? Just wave your one hand if that's correct. It doesn't matter, God, what denominational sticker you have on your forehead. God will touch Baptists. God will touch Episcopalians. it's probably easier to touch an Episcopalian than it is to touch a Pentecostal. No. Don't get your eyes off Jesus. Don't get to looking at me. You get to looking at me, you miss out. You miss out. Get your eyes back on Jesus. Get your eyes back on Him. Get your eyes right back on Him. Put your eyes back on Him. Put your eyes back right on Him. Come here, tender heart. And your dad and mom, come here. Come here. Bring him here. Chris, you come too. Line him up. Come here. Stand right there. Join hands. You know what he's been doing up to now? The Lord just tells me, he says, I've been burning off the tradition of yesterday and the religious things and the garments that you've carried of the past. I've been burning it off and stripping it off of you. Sometimes it's been painful because even some of the friends, people that knew you from days gone by, really think you've lost your marbles and they think that you've lost it and that you're just kind of out to lunch. But oh yeah, you've left the old, you've left the dregs for something better, saith the Lord. And yes. It shall increase, not just upon you, but your whole family and your children. And everybody else. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Don't want to leave anybody out of the blessing. Don't leave nobody out of the blessing. Hallelujah. 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 Come here. Come here, both of you. Quickly, both of you. Come here. Yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lift your hands. As you do, the power of God comes upon you. Fire. Fire. Sukumanina. Brevenenga. Menene mebavenenina bamba dem bamba du shamombre. Subhombre. Delevia. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Both you and your wife, just step out over there. Step out over there. Step out over there. Over there. Join hands. Fire! The fire of God. Supponti, Gibbet, Dilibo, Baba, Mendidia. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Come here. Norway, come here. Ture, come here. Come here, both of you. Stand right over there. Samona dia, my mama dia. Join hands. Join hands. It's only the beginning. See, there'll be constant moves of the Spirit of God, changes, transformations. People not even going to recognize you when God's finished with you. So great is going to be the change, the way you talk, the way you walk, the way you see things. You'll be an oddity in your own nation. People look at you, see you, say, where did you come from? But oh, the Spirit of God is just upon you for a special purpose and for a special task. Hallelujah. And it, even what he did just several weeks ago, he's going to increase it, increase it, increase it, increase it, increase it, increase it, increase it. Come here, Sammy, bring your wife, bring your family. Come, quickly, stand over here, stand over here. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Join hands. Thank you, Lord. You think you've seen blessing? You ain't seen nothing yet. You think you've seen increase? You ain't seen nothing yet. You stand on the brink of a great, yeah, pakananina, pelevena, brustom rebe, menenia, ha ha, sukonanina, melevena, melevan, bramban, denabugaleba, so forth. Come here, Ashley, bring your wife. Sukomanina, Sakumanina. Now, I'm telling you, if you leave here now, you're missing out. Just the Spirit of God. There's angels walking up down these aisles right now handing out gifts. There's angels of God walking up and down these aisles handing out gifts. Right now, handing out gifts. Handing out gifts. Increase gifts. Miracles. Yeah. Somoni, join hands. Somoni, step forward. Mamandi bondele ba bamba bandi. Tessa. I met his grandfather. He was 94 years of age just prior to going home. His grandfather stood with Wigglesworth and ministered with Wigglesworth. I tell you, this family, their great heritage. And what so blesses me in Australia is that I tell you, I saw it in churches all over there. The fathers that have left their sons now to take over. It's awesome. And they trust their sons to take over. I mean, that blesses me. I was so inspired going to Australia to see in America, there's a lot of people, they don't have nobody to take over their works, like a son. You know what I mean? But it's awesome. It's awesome. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. A special anointing. a special, unique, diverse, special. It's tailor-made for you, saith the Lord. A special mantle, a special anointing upon your life and upon your ministry, which shall be made manifest in the next 90 days after you arrive back home. A special mantle, not just on your husband, but on you too, lady. Ha ha. Rudene, brevida, bababa, balaba dida. Both of you will stand in that place. Both of you will walk in that realm. Both of you will step in that place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come here, Marion. Come here. Hallelujah. You've been faithful. And I've heard the cry of your heart, saith the Lord, you've been faithful with, it's not really been a little, you've had a whole much that you've been faithful with, but I'm going to increase it and double it and multiply it and increase it and multiply it. Ha-ha, that it'll astound. Yeah, people around you are going to be shocked and astounded. Your husband for one. Oh, yeah. Shocked and astounded at what I'm going to do to enter your life. Yeah, yep. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Come here, quickly. Yes, come here. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Fire! The fire of heaven right now upon you. Yeah, that's it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Hallelujah. Come here. Tom, come here. Stand over here. Come stand right over here. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lift your hands. Fire! Fire of heaven, even now. Thank you, Lord. Do work. Lord, increase tenfold. This next 12 months, multiply. Increase. Great harvest. We speak it by the Holy Ghost. Speak it right now. Increase. Come here quickly. Stand right over there. Fire. Sukumonina. Brevenene. Boshamamba. Bamba di. Bondi ba. Mamamba banda. Babanga leader. Mamamba ba ba ba. Ho. Samana ma. Brande. Sukumandi di be living in a megalinda. Proprio un dere bagli. Con delle bagli di. Come here, Big John. Come here. Quickly. So con anybody. So born in ma. So born in ma. You're gonna start singing soprano. No. No, that's not a word from God. I was teasing.
Fire!
I thank you, Lord, for the fire upon. That was just a joke. It was a Holy Ghost joke. He will not sing soprano. So come on, Baba. I just took you off God. I just got you off God. So come on, Baba. Meme bevidi, bamba dida, bamba dida, bomboridi, bebe bev, shum bombo, ha ha, mene, bombo, bamba, fa, fire, somonia, nenema, brujijima, bro baba, si potelebe. Oh, yes. Now, I'm telling you right now what's happened. Some of you got to looking and you're missing out. You got, shapakatia, you got to looking. You just got to looking and you're missing out. You got to looking. You're just looking. You're missing out. You're missing out on what the Spirit of God wants to do here tonight. I'm telling you right now, come here quickly. Quickly. Stand right over here. Lift your hands. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Yeah, come here quickly. Come here. Yeah, fire. Quickly, young man, come here. Matt. Fire. Sopuminiata, Renate. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. Fire of God. Take it, it's yours. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, you know what? The Lord told me to tell you something, Matt. It's real neat. Listen to me. He says, just have patience. Look at me. Come here. Pick him up. The Lord told me to tell you something real neat. Prepare. Have patience. I'll do that which I promised you. I'll do it. Relax. Enjoy the journey. You're still young. Enjoy the journey. I wish somebody had told me that 20 years ago. Oh, God. Oh. Whew. That would have helped me. Superna paradia. Samania tasha nombre. Hallelujah. Supurividea. I wish somebody could have told me. It would have helped me, Gabriel. It would have helped me. I need to kill myself. It would have helped me. Supurividea. Supurne mengele ba. Hatana ma. Pababati. Supurnea. Oh, where are you off to? You're not finished yet. Come here. Hallelujah. Phew. Wouldn't that be amazing if Big John got up and started singing soprano? It's a joke, Big John. It's just a joke. Jesus. This man has so been touched by revival. That's all he talks about. Everywhere he goes, he's one of the biggest thorns in the side of the Assemblies of God. Because everywhere he goes, he talks about revival. They wish he'd shut up because he keeps talking about revival. Everywhere he goes, he's radical. Big John goes where nobody goes. And he just goes in because he's been around. He's like an institution. He'd been around for years. Nobody even questioned. That's Big John Hall, don't touch him. He was there on the day of Pentecost. Don't leave him alone. Leave him alone, don't touch him. That's Big John. Everywhere he goes, that's all he does, talk about revival. Everywhere he goes, he irritates everybody in the religious world. They don't say anything to him because they can't. He's an institution. I hear the Holy Ghost saying a new dimension and a new realm. God said to me to tell you, he said the things that I spoke to you about many, many years ago that I promised you, that I placed within your heart. He said, I dropped it into your spirit years ago. And you've cried out to me and said, when? Come. You said, when? The Lord says, it's even now. It's now. It's at the door. There's a change. There's a shifting taking place. Don't worry. It's me. I'm doing it. I'm going to break you. It's going to be like a paradigm shift from where you are now to where you're going. But it's the land that you've desired. It's the place you've desired. It's the secret place. It's the cry of your heart. You'll have to pinch yourself because you think it died and went to heaven. So great will be the blessing. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. For you as well. Hallelujah. 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 A new dimension. A new dimension of the fire of God. A new dimension. Oh, yeah, there it is. There it is. There it is. Yeah, that's it. That's it. He slipped it on you right there like a coat. I felt it go right on you like a coat. There it is. There it is. Yeah. 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 Fire. Fire. That's it. Go right through you. More. More. Don't do that. I'm trying to lean on you. Just be a support. You're supposed to help me. Thank you. A new day, a new realm, a new dimension, a new realm, a new day, a new dimension. Can you imagine leaving the building? I know it's getting on, but you know what? Hey, this is about lives being changed. This is about lives being touched. Who gives a rip whatever else is happening? When you in the world used to go out in the town and drink up to 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning and didn't seem to bother you. Now that people get saved, they become totally party poopers and they have to go to bed by 9 o'clock. This is about lives being changed. This is about futures being changed. This is about direction being changed. God's changing the directions of people right now. God's changing directions of people right now. Adjustments are being made in the spirit. You didn't see the 9-foot angel standing behind you making some adjustments. You didn't see it, did you? You think you're just sitting there and nothing's happening to you. You didn't see the big angel standing behind you. Making some changes. Handing out gifts. Yeah. Just be faithful, because I'm preparing you, saith the Lord, for a work that I have for you, and it shall come forth at the appointed time. Be faithful, which he knows he will be, but he's just encouraging you. I'm being patient. It shall come. It will come. It will come. The vision's for an appointed time. It'll come. It'll come forth. Come in, Shreddy Pie. Come stand over there. You just like your mommy. Just like a mama. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Where are my children? I want them in a meeting from tomorrow. I don't care. I want him in the meeting. Come here. You're just like your mommy too. Feel right now. Top of your head to the soles of your feet. Hallelujah. I'll tell you, it's important. Get our kids under the anointing. Get him here. I want him here. I don't want him somewhere else. Go jerk him out of children's church and get him here. I don't want him in another thing. Get him here. Sitting around with puppets and muppets and praise God. Kids need to be under the Holy Ghost. You better join them. Give me some space. I need a bit more space. Fire! Fire! What's this? Jesus. Get him. Get him, Lord. Thank you. Bless my mummy, Lord. Bless my mummy. It's Big John Hall. Now, you might be sitting here tonight and you say, well, nothing's happening to me, but what you've got to understand is that you're getting hungry. That's one thing for sure. Come here, brother. Yeah.
Fire!
Pick him up. Look at me.
Fire!
My soul goes very well.
You make your face.